battling, I want us just to pray together as a church. And wherever you are watching online, I want you to believe God's healing you right there where you are. Father, right now, come on, let's not be spectators. Let's be participators in this and join with me in mutual faith. Father, right now, in Jesus' name, we thank you that you've declared in your word what your will is, that your word is your will. And so by faith, according to the facts of Calvary and your precious blood, we receive what you paid for us to have. According to Matthew 8:17, you took our infirmities and you carried our diseases. And so we declare, by your stripes, we are healed. Today, right now, in Jesus' mighty name. Now come on, let's give him a praise and thank him. Come on, praise is the big gun of faith. We praise him because it's true. There's joy because there's faith. We believe it's done. And we thank you for it, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Wow, what an awesome, awesome service already. Amen. Wow, I tell you what, somebody says, well, where are you going with this, Pastor? Sometimes I don't know where we're going. We're just letting the Lord have his way. Amen. Why don't you turn to somebody and give them a high five and tell them you're looking good this morning. Oh, right. Thank you. Thank you, Cameron. Glad you're here. Everybody survived the holidays. At least you're here in body. That's the start, right? So glad you're here, and we're excited about 2019 and excited about what God has for us. And if you're new around here, maybe you're not aware, we begin every year with 21 days of prayer and fasting. And we're going to talk a little bit about that today. Some of you are excited until you heard me use the word fasting. And you don't have to get excited about it in your flesh. But I promise you, as you see God move in your life, there's nothing more exciting than seeking the Lord and seeing him do what only he can do when we pray, fast, and seek his face. And so I want you, if you will, in the handout that you were given on the way in, if you would just open that up, and on the bottom right corner, we're setting our faith. Every year we set our faith in a theme, and we're declaring that 2019 is going to be a year of harvest, a year of abundant harvest. And what we mean by that is we're believing God to help us reach more people that are far from God and don't know Jesus this year than we ever have in our history. Amen? Really, that's our business. That's our mission as the church, is to reach people for Christ. And I want you to, and we're going to talk about this over the next few weeks together, but I want you to believe with us. And we've got in your notes there, we'll talk about some things that we're going to be corporately praying together about through the course of this next 3 weeks together with intensity. But I want you to believe with me. How many of you say, Pastor, I'll believe with you for a harvest of souls this year through this church, and not only what's the individuals that are born again in our services and all that we do as a church online, but also through our missions giving and the missions projects and missionaries we support throughout the world. And we're going to be sharing with you. We're going to start taking the first Sunday of every month and really start sharing with you all the missionaries that we do support, and we'll be putting some things in your hand so you'll feel better better informed about when you designate, whatever you designate in your giving towards missions, exactly where it's going, and so excited about that. But we're going to do some things this year to intentionally bring in the harvest. We've got to thank God for prayer, and we're going to be praying and believing and fasting, but we can't just stay in this building and beg for miracles. We've got to go outside the walls of this church. Amen. And so it's going to be wonderful. We're declaring that this year is also, it's going to be a year of marvels, wonders, and extraordinary manifestations of our great God. And somebody says, what is a wonder? Well, a wonder is really something that happens unexpectedly, or a sense creates a sense of surprise. And I believe that our God is a good God. I believe that He's working on a better blessing than you could have ever imagined right now behind the scenes for you. And as we seek Him and put Him first, and really, and we're going to talk about this too, that in our fasting and praying, this is more than just, we're not bringing our Christmas list. We're going to seek Him first and seek His face. And so as we begin today with our days of prayer and fasting, and this is the key, that we're to see the power of God in operation, the presence of God move and touch and change and transform people's lives. I believe that this is the key, is prayer and fasting. And it's going to take a higher order of prayer and intercession this year to see God do these powerful things. Turn with me, if you will, on the first part, on the first page there in your handout. How many of you have ever seen this phrase before? To get where you've never been, you have to do what you've never done. If you want to get somewhere you've never been, then you're going to have to be willing to do something that you've never done. We're going to have to pray for the lost, cry out and reach into the heart of God. And the Lord reminded me of the scripture, ask of me and I'll give you the nations as an inheritance. People, the loss. And so this is the key. This is going to, and this has to be a year, and we're going to help you this year, equip you to where you feel comfortable. You're not always going to feel totally comfortable sharing your faith, but you feel, let me say it this way, you're going to feel equipped to share your faith to where we live a lifestyle of loving people that are far from God. And wherever we are, we have a lifestyle, whether we're in the store or out and about, that we are able to share Jesus without fear and in love. And then also that you know that you're equipped and empowered to pray for people. Amen. And to see God move in their life and God to perform miracles, signs and wonders. And I believe we'll see those things. If you're hungry, how many are hungry to see the miracles and the things that we read about in the Bible? I believe they'll happen if we'll take God to the lost. And not just, and we should come to church with an expectancy. When we gather together corporately as a local church in a family, there should be a high expectation, obviously, but there should be an expectation that when we walk outside of these doors, that God could do anything. Amen. We have to give Him an opportunity to reveal Himself. I just wanted to take a few moments, just cast a little vision before we jump in to our teaching today. But I believe that if we'll continue to pray for those who are sick, I believe, and pray for miracles, that God will begin to draw people that are hungry. I believe people are hungry for more than just a 45-minute church service where we come in and do the same thing and have the music and have the teaching and pray and leave not changed. I believe people are hungry for more. There's been enough preaching and teaching, and you can get it on your phone 24/7. We need an encounter and an experience with the Word of God and the presence of God. Can I have an amen? And so we have to give God an opportunity, and we can't just sit here in this place and see that it's going to happen, especially for those of us who have been walking with God for quite a while. God's requiring of us that we walk in faith. And for you to take your faith outside these doors and share him with someone, he's going to require you to walk in faith. And God's requiring those, I believe those of you, and I can say this in love, those of you that have been serving the Lord for a while, you're mature in Christ. Many of you have served and known Jesus for many, many years. This year, God's requiring more of you. And you can handle that statement because you are mature. You're not a baby Christian. You have been serving, and he's requiring you. It's time for you to help with the babies. Amen? When we were raising our boys, when they were little babies, they would cry when they wanted something or they didn't get their way. At some point, as we grow older, it's not about me crying when I don't get my way, but now I'm going to help with the babies. Amen? And this year, if we're going to see the lost one and people grow in their faith, we're going to have to say, you know what, Lord, I don't want to be just a spectator anymore. I want you to use me. And I'm willing to help with those. That I want to make sure that the babies get an opportunity to know Jesus. Amen? You know why we get bored with church? Some of you are sitting here and you are bored out of your mind and you feel like we're going through the motions again. You know why we reach a place of spiritual boredom? Because you hear message after message. You listen to preaching. You sit in services. And you don't take that word and do something with it. The word was meant to be acted upon. Remember how God gave the Israelites manna? If they collected too much that they didn't eat, it got corrupted and it stunk. Well, that's a visual picture of what's happening. When you're not obeying what God's already told you to do, you can reach a place of spiritual boredom and you'll hop from church to church, listen to preacher or teacher after one after the other. This church don't have what I want. They don't have what I want. You need to take what you've heard and put it into action. Come on, somebody. And do something with what God's put on the inside of you. At some point, it's not about me anymore. It's about those that God's heart is broken for, that are lost and dying. He's empowered you, and he's equipped you and called you to go make a difference. Can I have an amen? Praise God. That's good preaching, even if I'm doing it. But here's the awesome things about this. But as you do, I believe as you step out into that, you're gonna be rewarded beyond your wildest dreams, because you're gonna start seeing God do miracles under your hand. And some of you have been praying for that, dreaming for that. And I believe if you'll just step up and take your place and say, it's not about me anymore, but it's time. Somebody shout, it's time. It's time to see the miraculous in the streets. It's time for the church to walk in power if we'll get out there where the people are. If we'll get out there where they are, and we're not out there to condemn people, we're out there to love people and to share and to lift people. Amen? I believe we'll be shocked. You'll be shocked. I've been so shocked. There's times I've shared Jesus and prayed with people and the miracles and the things just flow so easily. When you walk in the love of God and you do it out of a heart of compassion, it's amazing. And people that have no idea about Jesus or his word are going to come running to those of you, I believe, this year. If you'll spend time in his presence this year. And we're not talking about 8 hours a day. I'm not talking about that. But just give the Lord some time this year. Give him a little piece of your morning. Give him some of your evening. And if those of you fill with the Holy Spirit, pray in the Spirit. If you're not, get baptized in the Spirit. Pray in that supernatural prayer language. And you're going to watch God do miraculous things through your life. Just give him a little part of your morning and your evening. Pray in the Spirit. Intercede for the lost. I believe God wants this year to be the most startling year we've ever experienced as a church and as the body of Christ. Can I have an amen? Come on, give Jesus a big hand of praise if you truly believe that. And let me just say this. Can I meddle a little bit? God, I believe, wants to do some major reconstruction in this nation. But as the church, we're going to have to watch our mouth. And I believe God is moving on the political scene of our nation. This nation, the Christians have been praying and fasting, and if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, pray and seek my face, and we have been, and I speak for us, but the church worldwide crying out for America, and we're seeing some incredible things happen in this nation. But here's where we're going to need to turn the corner this year. For those of us that don't agree with someone on the far political side on the other end of the spectrum, instead of us getting into arguments, why don't we take their names and lift them up before the Lord and pray for them? I'm not saying, you know, be an ostrich, put your head in the sand and not be informed and not, you know, that's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying instead of us just getting frustrated and running our mouth, why don't we start praying and lifting it up before the Lord where he can do something? Amen? Praise God. Praise God. And that's when the change will happen, when we bring it before the Lord. God said he wants to heal. And God's not done with America. We need to see an awakening in this nation. We need to see a great awakening in this nation. I believe that we're going to. Praise God. So let's talk a little bit about this prayer and fasting. And we're going to share with you, there's some different ways that you can fast. I want you to participate on some level. Brooke and I, we've chosen this fast. A lot of times we're just led of the Lord and we pray about it and we talk about it together. And then we make a decision on what we'll do together. But we've chosen for the next 21 days to fast from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. and then just eat a light meal in the evening. And as I'm led by the Lord, there may be some days that I go 24 hours, but I'm just going to listen to the Holy Spirit. And you can't fall into the trap of legalism. Some people say, well, should we even be talking about fasting? You know, Jesus told us when we fast, don't let people know. Well, we're actually proclaiming a public corporate fast as a body, so we do have to talk about it a little bit. And so here's the number one thing we need to remember on this fast, the next 21 days. The number one reason we're doing this and we start off the year in prayer and fasting is to seek God first. Somebody shout first. First things first. Priority does matter. I said, our priorities do matter. So the statement we're making this year in prayer and fasting is, God, you're number one. Before I begin making long-term plans, I know you've already been looking at 2019 calendar as we have, but we pray along that calendar and make goals and plans according to hearing the voice of the Lord. The number one reason you need to go into this fast is to draw closer to Jesus. Write this down in your notes. Number one, prayer and fasting. Everybody say prayer and fasting. Just circle that in your notes because I think that's so important that if you just go without food and you don't pray, you might as well not fast. It's prayer and fasting. Prayer and fasting together are the power twins. So if you're not praying, you're just starving yourself. The power is in prayer and fasting. And I'd love for you to join us on Wednesdays over the next several weeks. We're going to have teaching in here. We're going to be studying fasting by Pastor Jensen Franklin in here together, and then we're going to split out into small groups, men and women together, have discussion and prayer time. And so this is an incredible opportunity for you to encourage one another, to even share your challenges through it together and lift each other up and not talk each other out of it, but just keep encouraging and loving on each other through this process and help each other grow spiritually. So fasting, number one, it's really about changing us more than changing God. I made the wrong assumption in times past where I would go into a fast or a time of prayer and fasting, if you will, and I had my mind on what I needed God to do for me. Oh, it's quiet in here. Y'all made that same mistake too? And you can read through Isaiah 58, but actually the Lord rebukes Israel for fasting in that way, telling them that they actually fasted for the wrong reasons. And you can go into a fast, and if you fast for the wrong reasons, you're not going to see any benefit at all. So I think that we need to go into the fast with a humble heart that says, Lord, I need you to change me. I'm going into this fast to seek your face. I want to know you more. Remember number one, James 4 and 8. Draw near to who? God, and he will draw near to you. There's something powerful that happens when you make a conscious decision of your will that you're going to draw near to God. He will draw near to you. And I've seen it happen throughout my entire life serving God as I've made conscious. Somebody says, well, you're turning God on and off. No, God's always on. It's me that turns on and off. It's me that's hot and cold. But we're coming into a season where we're dedicating these next 21 days and carve out time to pray. When you would normally eat, if you're going to fast a meal or however you're going to fast, pray. Spend time in prayer. And if you need to put the phone in the other room like I do, so I'm not distracted, to get quiet and to draw near to God and put some worship music on and just draw near. Take some time to worship him and get into his presence. So that's the power of prayer and fasting. We're seeking first the kingdom of God. Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God. In 2019, for you to fulfill your destiny, these are the words and the principle of Jesus. So these are the words of God. Seek first. Everybody say first. The kingdom of God. If things aren't going in a good direction in my life, it's probably because I'm seeking some other things first. I put my finances in front seat. I put some other things that are really the directional navigators of my life, and I love Jesus. I'm on my way to heaven, but I'm not really seeking first the kingdom of God. It's okay to love God, and it's good to go to church, but somebody says, that kind of sounds radical, Pastor. Well, you know what? It's the radical Christians throughout history that have made an impact on their generation, and I don't want to float through life in the dash from the date I was born to the date that I am buried, die and am buried, that dash to not leave an impact on my generation for Jesus Christ. Can I have an amen? I refuse for God to call us to plant and start this church and us not make an impact on Cypress, Texas, in our city, Houston, and beyond. God put you on this planet to make a difference and be an impact in your generation. Can I have an amen? But it's going to happen when we seek first the kingdom of God. Number two, prayer and fasting is about seeking God and reestablishing our priorities to make him first in our lives. We the cares of life are crazy, aren't they? We get so, and we're living in the busiest generation and culture, and we have so much to preoccupy our time. And so we have to get alone with the Lord, reestablish our priorities, and say, God, what do you want? Amen? What do you want? And guys, pull up that next scripture, the next slide. Paul makes this statement. For as I've often told you before and now tell you again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction. But notice what he says about them. Their God is their stomach. Other words, stomach is king, or flesh makes all the decisions. I'm hungry. I'm going to eat now. And if I don't, I'm going to cry. I'm going to throw a fit. I'm going to be mad. That's my flesh ruling my life. And I refuse to allow my flesh to be king in my life. Their glory is set in their shame. Their mind is set. Notice those that their God is their stomach. Their mind is set on earthly things. Jesus said, you'll know them by their fruit. And so we have to make a decision as children of the Most High God. We are in Christ. We're abiding in Him. He lives on the inside of us, that we say, no, flesh, you need to keep your mouth shut. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. God's going to be first in my life. God's going to be the one that tells me. I'm going to be led by the Holy Spirit. Remember what the Word says, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons, and we could add the daughters, the children of God. Amen. And so we want to be led by the Spirit of God. And look at this, Psalm 34:8. Taste and see that the Lord is good. God wants to be your ultimate nourishment. Hey, listen, I get it. I'm a foodie, man. I love the fact that Houston is a foodie town. And we just plan our vacations around where we're going to eat. Because when I go out of town or I go somewhere, or even if I'm going to, you know, a part of Houston that I'm not normally around, I'm looking on Yelp. I want something unique. I want something different. I want to try something that I've never tried before. And so it's so funny. I grew up in Northeast Texas, and I mean, you're talking fried chicken and chicken fried steak and just good old country cooking. And we've grown, these boys of ours, they grown up obviously in Houston. And it was so funny. We went to, this was probably sometime this past year. We went and ate catfish somewhere. And Jackson, my 9-year-old, he saw the hush puppies. And he said, Dad, are they serving falafel at this place? God love him, he didn't even know what hush puppies were. We're adventurous eaters. and love to try different stuff. But you know, there's a wonderful time. God gives us richly all things to enjoy, but not to rule over my life. Amen. There's a difference there. And so that's what we're going to do. And here's what I believe the Holy Spirit would be saying to us at the outset of this year would be, if I'm filled with other things, if I'm not hungry for Him, then I've already filled myself with other things. Can I have an amen? You see that in your notes there? I made the mistake growing up. My mom, that ticked her off. Made her mad. Sorry, Mom, if you watch this message. If I had eaten something and I wasn't hungry when supper time came around, she was not happy. But we can fill ourselves up with so much stuff. And hey, we love Netflix as much as the next person. There's some, you know, the boys, man, Amazon Prime, they like MacGyver. Come on, somebody. It's like, my boys will not grow up and not know who MacGyver is. Priorities. but if we fill ourselves up so much, and it could be anything and not anything wrong, not anything sinful, but if we're so filled with other things, if we're not careful, we can get out of balance, and then we're not, that hunger and that passion for Jesus should be number one. Amen? Jesus said, you're not cold or hot. I wish that you were, eat one or the other. That passion belongs to Him. There is a parallel with our relationship with Jesus that we are the bride of Christ. And we belong to Him. He purchased us with His own life. And just as a husband and wife, they are saying, not only are they saying yes to each other forever, they're saying no to all the 3 other billion men or 3 other billion women on the planet, whatever that number is. They're saying no. And that in that marriage covenant, they're saying, you say to your spouse, you are mine and I'm yours. And there's a level of intimacy there that doesn't belong to anyone else. Can I have an amen? And when we become one with Jesus, that deepest place of my heart, that deepest passion and hunger, that should be His and His alone. Can I have an amen? Does that make sense, anybody? So number three, we're going to deny our flesh and we're going to empower our spirit. You know, there's, if you've ever watched high jumpers in the Olympics, there's two different kinds. There's the regular high jumpers. They jump about 7 feet or so. Or if you're like me and you attempted to high jump, you jumped about 2 feet. But they run and they throw their backs over the bar. But there's another kind of high jumper. And they're called pole vaulters. And have you ever seen them? They launch about 18 feet in the air. And they back up. They look down that runway. They've got that pole. They start running down the track, and they stick that pole in the ground. And anybody tried that? I tried one time in high school, and I was glad nobody was there. That'd make a great, I would be a YouTube sensation today. They put all their weight on that pole, and I thought that would be to my advantage, and it wasn't. To use the pole to lift them to a level they would never be able to lift themselves on. And here's how this applies to some of us have mountains, don't we? We have things that we're believing God for breakthrough, and there's a crossbar. We've tried to high jump over it. And maybe you're like me. You went about 2 feet. Maybe you got good 1 year and went 3. And we've tried, why? We're trying to high jump it in the flesh. And we've said, mountain, you're not going to keep me down this year. This is my year. And we make New Year's resolutions, and we set our goals, and we try the power of positive thinking, and we're not going to repeat our mistakes, and we take off, and then we jump about 2 feet. But some of us have been jumping that same 2 feet for the last 30 years. And maybe what you need is a pole vault. Maybe what you need is something you can lean on when you get into a problem so you could go higher than you ever could on your own. You could ever lift yourself on your own. You need a pole that will help lift you over that mountain. And I'm believing this year that the pole vault for the bars of your life are going to be prayer and fasting. As you seek God first and you cry out to Him, you're going to watch God carry you and lift you beyond what you could ever do in the natural. Just as Peter walked on waters, he kept his eyes on Jesus. You're going to do miraculous things and seek God breakthrough for you. And it's not going to be your own power, and you're not going to get the bragging rights for it, but your God is going to get all the glory, and He's going to show Himself strong, and His goodness will be seen to a generation that's desperate to know, is there a God out there and does He love me? Can you give Him a hand clap of praise? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that we don't have to do this in and of our own ability. And that's what prayer and fasting is all about. The spirit is willing, Jesus said, but the flesh is weak. That's my problem. So here's what we do when we pray and fast. When I pray and fast, prayer connects me with God. That's why if you're not going to pray then just eat. Because when I fast, and I understand that the only type of fasting that existed for all of history up until this point was fasting from food, and I understand that scripturally, technically, that is fasting, is abstaining from food. But obviously there is benefit from disconnecting from the world in other words, in other ways, such as social media and different things. I'm not telling you to fast that, but you know you need to pray and ask the Lord and let Him show you what you need to disconnect from so you can pray and connect with Him. The goal is that we connect with God. And so we fast to disconnect from the world. And when we do that, you see, you have a different perspective, don't you? That's why number four is when we pray and fast, we change the way we see and hear. We change the way we see and hear. For some of us, your breakthrough is just looking and seeing it in a different way or hearing it from a different vantage point. And when you pray and fast and get alone with God and begin to see things as He sees them, then your breakthrough is right there. Number five, how about this one? When we pray and fast, so prayer and fasting changes us more than changing God. We're seeking God, reestablishing priorities, make Him first. We're denying our flesh, empowering our spirit. We change the way we see and hear. And then number five, we're hitting the reset button of our soul. Your soul is your mind, will, and emotions, and you can write that out beside the word soul, if that would help you. We hit the reset button of our soul, my mind, will, and emotions, to renew us from the inside out. Instead of attacking something from the outside, getting a change on the inside, it's never going to happen. The way God works, He begins on the inside. And He works us from the inside and changes the outside, and it begins on the inside. Reminds me of a middle-aged lady that this is just a story, so don't, when I say she had a massive heart attack and died on the operating table, people get sad, and this is just a joke. They're like, oh, when did that happen? Just a story, just a joke. So this middle-aged lady, she has a massive heart attack on the operating table, and she has a moment there with the Lord and says, Lord, is this it? He says, no, I'm going to give you 40 more years. Oh, thank you, Lord. So she gets off that operating table. And she gets a tummy tuck and liposuction and a facelift and Botox and has all this work done. And so 2 months later, she's driving down the road and she bought her a new car, new lease on life. And bam, somebody just slams into her and instantly kills her. And she shows up in heaven. She said, God, what happened? You promised me 40 more years. He looked at her and he said, oh, I'm sorry. I didn't recognize you. How do you know? I believe that if you will pray and fast, people, and participate on some level, and you allow God to work on you from the inside out, you won't recognize yourself in 3 weeks. People won't recognize you in 3 weeks. Who they'll recognize? They'll take note, as they did the disciples, that they had been with Jesus. They said they were ignorant and unlearned. You know what the Greek word was? Idiotos. They were idiots. But they noticed they had been with Jesus. Amen. I don't claim to be the sharpest knife in the drawer, but I tell you what I do have to offer. I love Jesus, and I want to spend time with Him. Amen. And look at number six, removing the clutter and increasing our sensitivity. We need to take time. Take time to remove the clutter, and you know what that is. You instant know what that clutter is. So you can increase your sensitivity to God. God will begin to speak to you. Maybe you're spending too much here. Maybe you're wasting time here. The Holy Spirit, and it never comes in a condemning way because He loves you. But he'll begin to put his finger on those areas. Like the guy had his credit card stolen, and the credit card company called him about 2 months later and said, "Sir, we found your credit card." And without missing a beat, he said, "Well, tell the thief to keep it. He spends less than my wife does." Maybe the Lord will start talking to you about areas that you had no clue, and he'll help you with, and it won't be from the flesh, it'll be by the Spirit. And here, that's how God talks, Acts 13:2, "As they worshiped and fasted, the Holy Spirit said." You say, "I wish God would speak to me." God's always speaking, but we're not listening. But if we'll position ourselves to hear, and when you pray and fast, and take time in your prayer time, not just to pray and petition, take time to worship and petition, but then take time to stop and listen. Take time to be still. And don't just rush up and run out of there when you've got everything off your chest, but take time to listen and take some scripture. And I've given you some promises here, some scripture on prayer, and take some other scriptures. Find whatever you're believing God for. Find some scriptures that you're standing on and drink deeply on them. In other words, think about them and very deeply. And as we do, here's what we can do. Number seven, we can expect results. Expect results. That's our faith in operation. When we expect God to do something, because he's the one that's promised. He's the one that's in. It's an invitation. We read through Scripture, men and women of God who have decided to seek God first. All these things will be added. What is it? That's putting expectation on what he's already said he wants to do. And we're going to expect. We'll be like the hillbilly that came into a church. He came down out of the mountains and came to a revival service, and he noticed, and it got a little warm. Guy walked back to the back and fiddling around with this little switch, and it got cooler in there, and he kind of liked that. So he asked that guy, he said, "What is that back there?" He said, "Oh, that's a thermostat." "Oh, okay." So on his way back out into the mountains, he stopped by the hardware store and bought a thermostat and went home to his cabin and mounted it on the wall. Thought, man, that was a nice $5 fix. It started fiddling with that thing, and back up to that church and said, "Man, you lied to me." Some of us have been fiddling with the thermostat. You've been trying to do things based on your flesh when there's a bigger issue behind it. I don't know if Ed's here, but he's worked on a lot of air conditioning units, and he can tell you there's a lot going on behind that little box. Amen. And there's a lot going on in the spirit realm that you don't know how to tackle it. You don't know how to deal with it. You don't know what the solution is, but God does. And as you'll pray and fast and bring that thing before the Lord, he'll give you his ability. And there'll be something besides just a little box on the wall. There'll be the power of God to make that thing go. Can I have an amen? Come on, why don't you give him a hand of praise? We thank you, Lord. So I've got in here, and we're not going to go over all of them, but I want you to take this home with you. And I've got some suggestions, different types of fasts, and that you can pray about, but participate on some level. And the number one thing I want you to do is make a commitment to prayer. And there's some different items that you can pray about, different types of foods, or maybe, you know what, maybe if you're spending 10, 20 bucks a week on Starbucks, and we're going to talk a little bit about missions, but you know, for a latte a week, you could support world missions. Start putting $5 extra in above your tithes and offerings and start helping support missionaries. And whatever it is, maybe you might have a habit or addiction, or if you, maybe you are trying to kick the habit of snuff or smoking, why don't you fast it? Say, you know what, on this fast, I'm going to fast nicotine for 21 days, and I'm going to lay it down. I'm going to say, Lord, help me, because I know you don't want me to die an early death. And I know you don't want me spending my money on this. Not a condemning thing. He loves you. He loves you, and he'll help you with it. Whatever it is, ask the Holy Spirit. He'll show you what it is. And here's where we go. Somebody says, well, what now? Number one, if we got the next slide, ask the Holy Spirit to guide you about what you should fast. Secondly, discuss it as a family. Communicate your convictions. Brooke and I, we're very clear. I let her know. She's trying to plan meals with the boys, and so just talk about it. Get on the same page. Number three, hold one another accountable in gentleness and love. Oh, I saw you eat that bag of potato chips. That's not gentleness and love. That's not really going to encourage anybody. That's just going to condemn. And listen, if you mess up and eat a Snicker bar, I messed up. Just forget the whole thing. No, just pick it back up and start anew and fresh. And God's not condemning you about it. He loves you, and he's proud of you. Amen. He's proud of you, and the Holy Spirit will encourage you because you're just drawing near to him. So hold one another accountable, and that's why I would love if you can make it on Wednesdays, and we have youth and kids ministry, and you can come, and we're going to dive into this powerful teaching together, and we're going to be able to love on each other and help each other. Number four, increase your prayer and Bible time. Increase your prayer and Bible time. Like I say, that's the number one thing. Draw near to God, and he'll draw near to you. And we passed them out last week. I don't know if we have any more, but we have started together as a church a chronological Bible reading, daily Bible reading, and it just takes us through the Bible in the historical order as the events happen, not laid out from necessarily like it is in your Bible, but it's laid out in historical as it happened, and just a few chapters a day. And if that plan doesn't work for you, find a plan where you're reading through the Bible this year and getting into the Word of God every day. Amen. You have to eat food every day physically, so you need spiritual food to grow and build your faith. And then number five, is there a number five? Yeah, journal through the process. If that helps you, if you're a writer, and as you're praying, as you're processing, you know, write things down. And here's another great way to reason to do that is because many times the Lord will speak to you and keep something on your nightstand. You may have in and out. There's a lot of times I'm in and out of sleep, and I'll have the Holy Spirit will just speak something to me, and I don't want to lose that. And so as you're through this time together, the Lord will talk to you, and you don't want to lose or forget what he gives you. But I believe this is going to be an awesome, awesome time together. Amen. Why don't we stand to our feet? So keep this with you. This is not just a handout. I know we try to do these a lot in our teachings, but this is really, and I'm not going to teach on prayer and fasting next Sunday. We're going to kind of shift gears. But this is actually for you to keep with you over the next 21 days and even throughout this year. And you say, well, what do I pray about? Well, I've got about 48 things just for starters that we're praying about together. And a lot of these things talk about for you personally, but also for our church and for our city and for our president and members of Congress. And pray for God to help you to guide your decisions. Pray for the people you work with. Yeah, they need prayer. Well, you need to pray for them. And pray for crime to decrease in our city. Pray for our police, fire, sheriff, public servants. So many awesome things on here that'll help you in your prayer life. And so begin begin in prayer, worshiping, thanking, and praising God. Amen. And then move into the petitions and things, and then take time to wait on the Lord, to hear His voice, to cultivate a sensitivity to Him. And I'm telling you, it's going to be life-changing. Transform you from the inside out. Amen. I don't know about y'all, but I kind of need a soul detox. I need a physical detox. And we're going to do that, but more than that, I need a soul detox. And I need to just reprioritize and say, Lord, You're first. You're first. Well, let's just worship Him for a moment. Lord, I thank You. We worship You and thank You for the privilege. You're giving us an invitation to draw us to Yourself. So Jesus, as You draw us, we say, here we are. We're coming, Lord. We accept this invitation to draw near to You over these next 3 weeks, these 21 days. And Lord, we don't want it just to be 21 days, but we want a lifestyle change where this carries on through the entire year and for the rest of our lives, that we have a lifestyle that we seek first the kingdom of God, that we stay sensitive to You. And Lord, I just thank You for the breakthroughs. People are believing You. People are believing for many, many different situations, physically or debt that they're facing and challenging situations with their business or their family. So Lord, we thank You today for Your supernatural strength as we humble ourselves before You. We're going to see You do powerful, powerful, mighty things. We thank You for it, Father. We thank You for it in Jesus' mighty name. And if you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus, just invite Him into your heart and say, Lord Jesus, I believe that You died on the cross for my sins and that You rose from the dead for me. I accept You as my Savior. I believe, I put my trust in You for my salvation today. I ask You to change me from the inside out. Invite the Holy Spirit to come in, and He'll change you from the inside out. If you're watching online, just pray right now and ask Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name, we thank You for it, Lord. Amen and amen. Well, give the Lord a good hand of praise if you believe it. Hallelujah. Julie, do we have that video? Yes? Okay. All right. Be seated for a moment. I want to share this video with you real quickly before we worship in our tithes and offerings and leave today. And besides, but you know, most of you, maybe you're fasting, so you don't need to leave to eat anyway. But just for a few moments, we want to share with you, as I said, we're going to start sharing the first Sunday of each month, a different missions focus, world missions focus, and so you can be more informed. And as you prepare your tithes and offerings, if you'd like to prepare something and designate something as missions, this is something that we support. And actually, our kids next door in Kids Church, they're learning about this as well. And they're going to be coming home with these little boxes. And hopefully this will help explain what that's all about.
Every cup of cold water given to a child in His name would not lose its reward. We have to have a big enough heart to care for people, to care for children, to care for the poor, to meet their needs. And as one African brother said one time, when my mouth is no longer thirsty, my heart opens up to the Word of God.
BGMC stands for Boys and Girls Missionary Challenge. We want to challenge our kids to pray for missionaries, to learn about countries and people groups, to do what they can to help our missionaries through sacrificially giving. And most of all, we want to challenge our kids to keep their hearts open to the call of God.
You see, kids learn about missions. They learn about the poor people of the world. They begin to pray in their hearts, wanting to do something, and then someone gives them a little barrel. And so those kids take that barrel home, they begin to earn money, and they begin to fill that barrel with change, with dollars, with their love, their concern, their care for the world.
I was called to be a missionary when I was 5 years old because missions and missionaries were put in front of me all the time. That's what BGMC does for our children.
Jesus loved the poor and the suffering, and BGMC is training our kids to have that same love and compassion for hurting and desperate people.
Participating in BGMC helps you share with your children that they have a responsibility that is bigger than they are and bigger than their local circumstances. It's a responsibility that reaches all the way around the world.
We do about 20 to 50 major citywide outreaches every single year. We're feeding thousands of kids every single day, and BGMC has been an incredible partner in providing resources to help us get that job done.
Just a few months back, we were able to go into a very restricted area in India called Nagaland. Over 1,000 kids came, over 750 of them come down and asked Jesus Christ into their life. Everything we had was bought by BGMC.
Well, the purpose of Global Initiative is to equip the church to reach Muslim peoples and to mobilize church planting teams amongst Muslim peoples. And one of the ways that BGMC has really helped us is with our Muslim evangelism training schools.
Because of the fact that BGMC is there for us and sends these funds, and we get an allocation for Northern Asia, I can respond to them, yes, we can help, because the children of America have helped us.
I'm standing in Atakpame, Togo, in West Africa, and we represent Africa Oasis Project, and thanks to you, we are drilling a deep freshwater well at a Bible school here in Atakpame.
We believe that children should be involved in missions as they grow up, become adults, then it just becomes a natural part of their life.
It's very infectious. You get involved, you see a project that touches not only children around the world, but it touches humanitarian needs, it touches spiritual needs.
It's that heart of compassion that cares about the lost, the poor, those who don't have as much, so that our kids will desire to reach out to these people around the world.
Well, we'd like everyone, every church in the Assemblies of God, to help us with two things. Number one, teach your kids to care about the world. Teach them to know about the needs of the world, the lost people of the world. And then number two, you get behind them. You pray for the world. You pray with them. You give with them. Every dollar that you give to BGMC goes to help our missionaries, home and abroad, reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Awesome. Isn't that cool? So our kids are going to be coming home with these today, and just to help them begin giving towards missions. So if you don't have any spare change around the house or in the car, hopefully you'll find it in this box. But we want to continue this year to share with you, because we're going to have to probably cover more than just one missionary a month, because we have so many that we support. And so whatever you designate to world missions is actually given across the board to all the missionaries and missions projects that we support nationally and internationally. And so they all of them that we support get an equal share of that. And so obviously the more that you designate to missions, the more that they'll receive from that. And so we've made a commitment, a minimal monthly commitment, to several missionaries. And we're going to make sure they get that commitment, whether that comes in designated to missions or not, just because we're going to do it. But really, the best way is for us together as a church, rather than having to support missions just out of the general fund, is if we'll all catch the vision and even just start small and say, you know what, Lord, I'm going to give up a latte a week and designate $5 or whatever to world missions, and then let the Lord increase you more and more. And we're so blessed in this nation, aren't we? And there's so much, so little that we have can go such a long way in different parts of the world. And so I just want to encourage you, is that Pastor Tommy, why don't you come and lead us in our tithes and offerings time before we exit today. And listen, if you're new to Harvest Family, love for you, love to get to know you, and love to welcome you to the family and get to know you a little bit better. If you'd love to join Brooke and I in the mom's room, which is around this hallway to the end of the hall behind the ladies' restroom, we have some snacks there. Won't keep you all afternoon, but would just love to meet you and get to know you. And so our ushers are coming at this time as you prepare your giving. Pastor Tommy, don't you love this guy? Won't you give him a hand? And God bless you as you worship in your tithes and offering.
Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, aren't you so excited about giving time? Thank you, Lord Jesus. What an awesome, awesome message from our pastor. Amen. Praise God. Why don't y'all give Pastor a hand today for the word of God? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Fasting and prayer. Isn't that a challenge for us? But I'm so glad that our pastor challenges us. The Holy Spirit, boom, put in him to challenge us as believers to move forward in our fasting and prayer. And today, I want to challenge you today, praise God, as you heard, to give to missions and to give for the upbuilding of God's kingdom. How many is ready for the challenge today? Praise God. Two of us. That's okay. Praise God. One can put what? 1,000 to flight. Amen. And two, we're going to put 10,000. Amen. Praise God. So today, why don't we stand today and lift up that giving, lift up that tithe, lift up that mission. And we're going to thank God today for miracles that are going to happen in your lives. Praise God. Do you believe it? Let us pray. Father, we thank you, Father, for the challenge today. Father, as we give, Father, to those missionaries, as we give here to harvest and to plant seeds, Father, where miracles are going to happen today in our lives, Father. Breakthroughs are going to happen in these communities today, Father. And we are the light of the world, a city that is set on a hill that cannot be hidden. We thank you for your power today. We thank you that breakthroughs are coming, Father, here today through our fasting and our prayer. We thank you for challenging us today. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father. We bless you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Why don't you put your hands together if you believe God? Amen and amen. Why don't you give? You can give. Amen. Thank you, Lord. You're dismissed. Y'all have a wonderful, wonderful day.
If you try to feel the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life.